Next on Unsolved Mysteries. A teenager falls in love with a man twice her age, but their storybook romance ends in murder. Many believe the Shroud of Turin is the actual burial cloth of Jesus Christ. Skeptics claim it's a forgery by a talented painter. Kurt Borton was declared missing in action in Vietnam, but his family believes he's returned to the U.S. with a new identity. And Texas firefighters discover the burned body of a young woman tied to her own bed. Perhaps you can help catch her killer. These are chilling cases that you won't want to miss. I'm Dennis Farina, and for the next hour, this is Unsolved Mysteries. Manatee County, Florida. When Annette Schopker was 16, her family moved from Ohio to Florida. Annette was on the shy side.
Annette discovered that it was very hard to fit in with the clique of friends. And she missed that terribly because she was so much a part of high school in Ohio. So she ended up dropping out of high school and got a job as a checkout girl at one of our local grocery stores.
Hey, Annette, can you come here a minute?
At work, Annette finally made a friend, the butcher, Jim Burnside, who was 28 years older than she was.
Well, listen, I was wanting to ask you, there's a little restaurant down where I keep my boat, and I was wondering if you might join me for dinner tomorrow night.
At that time, she was only 17, and this man was almost as old as her dad. We really hoped that she would meet somebody more her age, but she was so much in love with him that we finally agreed to meet him. But I didn't like him from the first time I met him. There was just something about him that I really don't know how to put into words. I just did not feel comfortable with him at all.
Despite her family's concerns, Annette married Jim. The bride was just 18, the groom was 46. But it wasn't a fairy tale marriage. For Annette, it was the beginning of 6 years of physical and emotional abuse.
She became afraid of him almost immediately because he was jealous of her, and when he was drinking, he was violent and made remarks to her all the time that she would never ever leave him. He started telling her right from the beginning that he would kill her if she ever tried to leave him.
Hello? Annette, where are you?
That's not important, okay? I just wanted to let you know I'm all right.
Just before her wedding anniversary, Annette took refuge in a local shelter for battered women.
I can't.
Either come back now or I'll get even with you.
He told her over and over again, if he couldn't find her, she would suffer.
Kill your family.
She would absolutely suffer because he would kill her family. And Annette felt like she didn't have any choice.
All right.
I told her, don't stay with him because of us. I would rather be dead than to have you live a life like this.
Good thing you're here. I have something for you. Here, honey. Welcome home.
Over the next few years, Annette and Jim had two daughters, and for a while, it seemed things were improving. Annette took a job as a receptionist for a local car dealership. One of her co-workers there was a salesman, who we'll call Dave.
Annette actually asked my advice and said, well, what'd you think about an automobile? I want to buy a car. Told me that she just wanted a little bit more freedom because he always dropped her off and picked her up. She took the car home and not more than, gosh, I don't know, 3 days a week, wreck it.
Take care of her.
Mommy, what's the matter?
Nothing's the matter. I'm just gonna get you back to bed, okay?
Now callous to you trying to leave. Can't you get it through your head that you're not leaving me?
He said, if you ever try to leave me, I'll kill you. I will kill this whole family. And Stacy was only 5 years old at the time, and she looked up at him and she said, Daddy, you wouldn't kill me. And he looked her right in the face and said, yes, I would kill you. And it just upset Annette so bad. She would tell me the way she was being treated. And it was just tearing me up to see what she was going through.
The next day, when Jim was at work, Annette called the police. They escorted her and her daughters to safety.
She said that she'd made up her mind that this is it. She's not going to stay with him another day. If he kills her, then he's going to have to kill her because she cannot live this way anymore.
By the time Jim came home, Annette was on a plane to Ohio. She took her daughters to stay with relatives, then secretly returned to her job in Tampa Bay.
He had no idea where she was, but in the meantime, Jim was calling us with these threats and telling us that this divorce was never going to be final. It would never see its final day.
When Jim discovered that she was back in town, he began to spy on her and was often seen near the dealership.
Could not get any help from anybody, even the sheriff's department. When we went there, it was like, Jim has to do something. We just cannot arrest the man. He's got to do something before we can do anything with him.
The day before Annette was scheduled to appear in court for a divorce hearing, she met the man we're calling Dave for lunch.
Hey. Hi, Dave.
How's it going?
Good.
Well,
she was smiling and happy and all of a sudden, her smile turned to most horrible fear. I got out of the automobile because I knew if I didn't do something, this could be the end for Annette. He looked at me like he was just about to enjoy a large steak. I watched the fire come out of the gun, and it was like slow motion. You could feel each one go in just like a hot poker.
By the time Dave regained consciousness, Annette was dead. Jim stabbed her 15 times with a 10-inch butcher knife. Jim Burnside escaped on foot in broad daylight. He bought a bicycle and army camouflage fatigues. He withdrew $500 from an ATM and disappeared.
What I'd like to see is James Burnside off the streets, not because of what he has done to me, mostly what he has done to his own children, his wife. This is why he has to be taken off the streets, because he's going to do it again.
She knew in her heart she was not going to make it. I knew in my heart she was not going to make it. And I just hope and pray that somebody spots him. We never will feel safe until we know Jim has been caught. It's bad enough knowing that Annette had to die, but to know that he is still out there, it's horrible.
Update. The night this story aired, two viewers called to report that Jim Burnside was living in Alabama under the assumed name Al Wilson.
When I saw his actual picture, I just looked at my husband and I just started pointing and I'm going, tell me my eyes aren't deceiving me. You know, that is Al. And he goes, yes, that's Al.
First thing I thought is that, well, hey, you know, let's call up the authorities and get this guy off the street.
Burnside was working as a carpenter at a flea market just outside Chelsea, Alabama.
We had received a call from the FBI office in Birmingham stating that they felt pretty sure that James Burnside would be at this flea market on Highway 280 located in Shelby County.
You got a fellow hanging around here by the name of Al Wilson?
Yeah, he's right there on the roof.
And apparently Burnside saw them and went towards his truck.
FBI, up!
Burnside pulled out a .357 Magnum and pointed it at the officers.
Put your gun down! Put your gun down! Hang him up!
Burnside was shot twice, placed under arrest, and taken to a Birmingham hospital.
What we've been able to determine talking to his co-workers, he had made a statement on Thursday morning that he had anticipated having problems that day. So apparently he had viewed the Unsolved Mysteries himself Wednesday night.
Burnside pleaded no contest to first-degree murder. He was sentenced to life in prison with no chance of parole. Coming up, the mystery of the Shroud of Turin. It could be the actual burial cloth of Christ or a forgery. The face of Jesus Christ, it has inspired artists throughout the ages. But how do we know what Jesus looked like? A piece of linen may hold the answer. It's called the Shroud of Turin. According to the Bible, after he was taken from the cross, Jesus was wrapped in fine linen. Many believe that somehow his image was imprinted on that linen.
When I first began to study the Shroud of Turin, I was convinced it was a crock and that it would take me probably less than 2 hours to put away this pious fraud. After all, anyone with an IQ of 100 or over knows that all relics, by definition, are frauds. But I must admit, here I am some 17 years later, I who came to scoff have stayed to pray. My own personal belief is that the Shroud is probably authentic.
It was in France during the Renaissance that the Shroud was first shown publicly. Eventually, it was moved to Turin, Italy, where it was rarely shown in public. 3 centuries later, the Shroud was photographed for the first time. Surprisingly, the photographer's negatives showed more detail than can be seen by the naked eye.
He was to write of this experience years later and would never forget that as he lifted that glass plate, he believed that he was the first person in 2,000 years to have seen the face of Jesus of Nazareth.
Dr. Robert Buckland, a forensic pathologist, has examined life-size photographic negatives of the Shroud.
The body shows a number of injuries. On the head, we see a series of blood stains around the forehead, high in the scalp, and along the posterior portion of the scalp. These are consistent with the application of a crown or a cap of thorns. On the chest area, there's a rather unique wound. It is quite consistent with a puncture-type wound made by an implement which entered the chest cavity and produced an outflow of both blood and water. In the region of the left wrist, there's a puncture wound which was clearly made by some implement which passed into the tissues of the wrist and produced bleeding.
The crucifixion of Jesus is usually portrayed with nails driven through his palms. But modern research has confirmed that at the time of his death, nails were, in fact, driven through the victim's wrists.
The Romans did enough of these, sometimes 500 a day, to be excellent anatomists. And like a butcher, they knew where the bones were. They put it in the wrist and it held the body and held it well.
In 1978, the Shroud was made available to a number of scientists for the first time. Using particles lifted from the Shroud with adhesive tape, biophysicist John Heller and chemist Alan Adler determined that there was blood on the cloth. They found chemical evidence of severe torture, consistent with crucifixion. Their findings, however, are not universally accepted. Some claim that the Shroud is a forgery, that it's the work of a highly skilled artist who painted with such tiny brushstrokes that they can't be seen by the naked eye.
When I first started working on it, I expected it to be authentic, and I looked for body fluids. That's the way I started. But the red turned out to be red ochre and another pigment, vermilion. These are common artist pigments. There's no question in my mind that it is a painting.
Many copies of the Shroud were made. It was felt by pious people at that time, if you touch the copy to the original, it would give the copy extra sanctity. It's called a brandium, is the technical name. When they were touched, of course, some of that pigment ended up on the shroud, and that is what has been discovered. But it is not responsible for the image, let alone the whole body image, total front and total back.
Dr. Max Fry, a Swiss botanist, also examined the tape samples. He discovered plant pollen trapped in the shroud. These microscopic organisms have hard shells that allow them to survive for thousands of years. Some of the pollen came from the Middle East, including the area around Jerusalem where Jesus was crucified.
I think it's impossible in an awkward spot at this point because Max Fry was a friend of mine, but I think that he wanted the shroud to be real so badly that he found pollen grains, which I didn't find. I had another set of tapes, and I did not find the same pollens.
Other scientists have studied the shroud. Optical specialist Kevin Moran claims his computer analysis revealed that the image has unique optical qualities. He believes they confirm the shroud's authenticity.
When I take a normal photograph, such as this child, and I place the child under the analyzer, you can immediately see a very distorted figure. The nose, with respect to the cheek, is totally distorted. And this is because this is a reflected image. This image is made by reflected light. This is not what we see on the shroud. The shroud is a very different type of image. The image immediately comes into a three-dimensional form. The eyes, nose, mouth relationship are all clearly recognizable. The image on the shroud is so unique that it almost enters a scientific faith factor all by itself. There simply is no way that we can duplicate this image even today, and people have certainly tried.
Among them was investigative journalist Joe Nickel. He created this pigment on cloth replica of the face on the shroud. It exhibits some, but not all of the characteristics displayed by the shroud image.
This is the Joe Nichols painting. You'll note the height of the hair and the height of the forehead, the nose, cheek. These are all quite at the same height. There's no proportioning or no shading. Here's the man of the shroud. Notice particularly that the nose is sticking above the rest of the face. The proportions of the cheeks to mouth to chin area in respect to the nose are quite good. Notice how the hair actually stands up a little bit, but not too much.
In addition to Moran's findings, believers claim that the absence of brush strokes on the shroud proves it's not a painting. However, skeptics point out that Leonardo da Vinci's brushstrokes were often invisible. In an effort to resolve this controversy, the Vatican allowed samples to be cut from the outer edges of the shroud. Three universities were given a tiny piece for carbon dating. Dr. Paul Damon headed the carbon dating team in the United States. Their findings placed the shroud's origin between 1290 and 1360 AD.
With less than 5 minutes, we could see that it could not possibly be first century. The difference between 14th century and first century is so great that you could see it within a few minutes in the first measurement. We made quite a few measurements, something like 16, but that was enough.
The rest of us would say we have no disagreement with what they dated, but are you sure you dated the main body of the shroud, or might you have dated a patch or a reweave?
My co-principal investigator, who is Irish from an Irish Catholic family and tried to be quite blasé about the whole process, looked very dejected. And I said, Doug, what's wrong? And he said, I didn't think I'd be disappointed, but I'm terribly disappointed.
The Vatican accepted the results of Paul Damon's carbon dating, which matched the test done in Switzerland and England. Since then, questions have been raised about the carbon dating process. The Vatican has refused to allow further testing, but it did approve a major restoration. Critics say that that restoration will make further research even more difficult. Consequently, the real truth about the Shroud of Turin may never be known And many say that it doesn't matter. Next, a woman claims to have seen her brother more than 25 years after he was declared missing in action in Vietnam. Washington, D.C., the Vietnam Veterans Memorial. Along with the 58,000 who lost their lives, it also lists the names of hundreds of GIs who are officially unaccounted for. The name of Robert C. Borton, Jr., known as Kurt, can be found here. But his family doesn't believe that Kurt's name belongs on this wall. They are convinced that he is still alive and has come back to the United States with a new identity.
I know my brother Kurt's alive. I've seen him on three separate occasions in Washington, D.C., and I have not one doubt in my mind that that was my brother, and he's very much alive to this day.
When Kurt enlisted into the Marine Corps, he was 19 years old. And then only days after arriving in Vietnam, he was on a patrol near the city of Da Nang, and he went missing. His father, Robert Borton, received that visit that every parent of a Marine dreads.
Yes?
Mr. Robert Borton?
Yes?
I'm Captain Victors. This is Lieutenant Jeffries, Casualty Office, United States Marine Corps.
Is this about Kurt?
Yes, sir. I'm afraid we do have some bad news about your son. He has been reported missing in action.
I don't know what to think. He really hit me hard. They said he'd missing in action, so I had hopes they'd find him right away. And listening to the news all the time, hoping something would come up where they'd found him, but it never did. Never happened.
2 years passed with not a single word about Kurt. Then, a glimmer of hope.
Robert?
Yeah?
Come here a minute.
We subscribed to a Marine magazine, and I was just going through it, and all of a sudden I see this picture, and it just jumped at me like, there's our son. I wasn't expecting to see a picture of him, but it was him.
I said right then, there's my boy. Ain't no doubt it is his picture of him.
The photograph had been taken a full year after Kurt was reported missing. Then, a few years later, the Bortons came across this frame from a film shot in a Viet Cong prison camp.
I seen that there, and as soon as I seen it, I said, there's my boy again right there.
I'm like him, there's our son again, no doubt. You know your children when you see them.
Each of the service members in that photograph have been positively identified. We've spoken to each one of them, and none of them is Robert Borton.
But there are other reasons that Kurt's family believes he is still alive. Robert says that he was approached by two strangers who claimed to be agents from the Department of Defense.
You're Kurt Borton's father, is that right?
Yeah, you got information about him?
No, we have no information we can give you, but we do have a letter we need you to sign for us.
What's this about?
Well, basically, it changes his status from missing in action to killed.
What do you mean killed? Nobody told me he was killed.
You want to know for my son's own personal safety, I declare him dead. They told me I'd get a large sum of money.
You guys are, and I don't know what's going on, but I'm not signing any letter.
Now, we don't work that way. We do things in a very professional manner. We would not approach someone and solicit them to change their son's status in a public parking lot of a shopping mall.
I feel like I should talk to a lawyer before I sign your stuff.
Robert says the two men approached him several times, always in a public place. Robert is functionally illiterate, and eventually, he signed the document without knowing what it said.
And so I agreed to declare him dead for his own safety. When they told me for his own safety, then I knew he was alive then.
Robert says he then received a check for $43,000. The men swore into secrecy, but he eventually told his family about the strangers. They decided to go to Washington, D.C. to further investigate Kurt's case. On several occasions, the Bortons were allowed to examine Kurt's official files.
During the early morning hours of an unrecalled day in March or April 1966.
What?
Diane claims that the entries regarding his death kept changing.
Some of these reports.
They had him killed in March or April of 66. In 1967, they have a story of him being with an engineer crew and being killed. They had him killed on paper several times.
I think a lot of what the families read, it may be the report of a witness. These people, Vietnam villagers, are remembering things that happened to them 25 years ago. So there are often errors in years. There are often errors in months. Many times they only understand things from the cycles of planting and harvesting their crops.
Every time I go and check out his file, there's something new.
Like what?
Well, this time I went and... Did you hear that?
Yeah, it's probably your call waiting.
I don't have call waiting.
Diane and other family members became convinced that their phones were tapped.
I started having several phone conversations with Diane, and she was giving me a lot of the information that she had.
One of Diane's cousins is certain that the entire family was being watched. He asked that his identity not be revealed.
Every morning, there would be a car pull out of the office parking lot, and they would follow me into work, and then I'd find them behind me again on my way home.
You guys have been following me for a while. I figured I'd let you know where I was, just in case you know.
After that, for about a month and a half, 2 months, I wasn't followed anymore. And then we started noticing them again.
Diane's cousin worked at a security company. She asked them to enter Kurt's social security number in this system.
I entered it into the computer and it came back invalid entry. That number's never been issued. That same day, I had left work, was headed home, and I was approached by someone. They very pleasantly called me by my name.
Hi, how you doing?
Listen, what you did today was really stupid.
I don't know what you're talking about.
Yes, you do. Now leave it alone.
A few years later, Diane moved to a suburb of Washington, D.C., where she believes that she actually saw her brother.
It looks like it's going to snow, doesn't it?
I was stunned it was my brother. And I didn't even have time to react because as soon as he said that, he got in and took off. It didn't look like it was going to snow. It was October. It was clear skies. And that's the only thing he said to me.
The next April, Diane claims that she saw her brother again.
We were headed down 395, and a red car pulled up beside us. I looked over, and it was my brother.
That's Kurt!
It was the same red car I'd seen at the gas station. He looked at me, and he grinned and shot in front of us and, like, slowed down a little bit. And I wrote down the license number, and then he sped up and zipped over in the other lane and zipped off the exit, which was, that was at Quantico Marine Station.
Diane traced the license plate number to a man who lived in Virginia, but he claimed to know nothing about Kurt. By this time, Diane says that at least one of Kurt's war buddies had confirmed that Kurt was alive, but that he had become a disturbed and dangerous man. And then she saw her brother again.
Let's go this way, okay?
Mom, that's Kurt!
Come on.
Mom,
let's go.
Right there!
Let's go home.
Mom, please talk to him.
I had been told that he was potentially dangerous. I had my two children with me, and I just couldn't take that chance that he could possibly be dangerous and harm our children. I know now that was a mistake. And if I had it all to do over again, I would have turned around. I would have faced him. I would have talked to him. I would have threw my arms around him and hugged him. But I was afraid.
Then Kurt's father received a disturbing phone call.
Hello?
Is this Robert?
Yes, who's this?
I can't mention any names. No names. Your son had a blonde-haired babysitter. What was her name?
Frieda Smith.
Frieda Smith.
Yeah! Is that my son? Is he there?
So I knew right then it's him. He must be in the background. And then they made a statement they'd be seeing me soon.
I can't tell you anything more, but he'll be seeing you soon. Don't tell anyone.
Wait, hello? Hello?
And I haven't heard another word from him. I figured he'd probably get in touch, but I haven't heard no more, and I hope I didn't jeopardize his life or anything but tell anybody.
The following year, the Bortons were asked to come to a meeting at Marine headquarters.
We have discovered some remains that we believe belong to Kurt.
And what did you find?
We found 11 teeth in a gravesite.
Where did you find them?
I asked him, where's the rest of his body? All he have is teeth. They says, well, there was grave robbers, and they came and they robbed the grave and took the body. And I'm thinking, Well, this is kind of dumb. What, did they just leave the teeth?
We know that there is remains trade in Vietnam, where remains are buried, dug up, and moved to another place, dug up again, and sold to remains traders. So they miss many of the smaller pieces. So often we find only teeth. Forensic experts tell us that these teeth were from a deceased person, and the teeth do match Robert Borton.
Looks like it's going to snow, doesn't it?
Today, the Borton family believes that Kurt is, or was, part of a secret government operation.
Robert Borton would not be a candidate for any type of secret mission. He was a very young man. He was in the Marine Corps just over 6 months. He did not have any special skills. He did not have a security clearance or any linguistic skills that would have been needed for some type of a covert operation.
What did happen to Kurt Borton? Despite the official record, his family remains convinced that he is very much alive and that one day he will finally come home. Coming up, a woman is found tied to her bed and burned to death. Her killer is unknown. The Lufkin, Texas Fire Department arrives at the scene of an apartment fire. The firefighters waste no time tracking down the source of the blaze. It's in apartment 616. As they put out the fire, they find a chilling scene. Tied to the bed is the charred body of a woman.
Fully involved, we arrived on scene, the neighbor downstairs.
She had been suffocated with a plastic bag and her throat had been cut very deeply, two different cuts, one on each side. And then the bed had been set afire. This crime was absolutely the meanest thing I've ever seen one person do to another.
Dental records identify the victim as Megan Curl, a 26-year-old, slightly retarded woman who had recently escaped from an abusive marriage. Could Megan's search for new companionship have led to her murder?
Because Megan was so trusting and was so outgoing, she tended to be an easy target for some of these men. Men absolutely could tell that Megan wanted to please, that Megan wanted somebody to care for her, and that she was lonely. And I think that that is part of what happened here.
On the night of her murder, Megan went to a local nightclub.
She was seen talking with a man at the Electric Cowboy Club, and that man did buy her one or two drinks. No one at the club knew who this man was, and no one reported ever seeing him there before or since. She went to another club called the Sport Shack, just a little ways down the road from the Electric Cowboy Club. She talked to some people there and caught a ride with an employee of the Sport Shack home.
A close friend who lived in the same apartment complex waited up for Megan to hear the details of her night out. She asked that we alter her voice to protect her identity.
Well, we were standing out there talking, and all of a sudden, there was this guy in his car, and he was speeding really fast, and he just did a dead stop.
Hey, you know what? I think that might be my friend from the club.
Really?
Yeah, I think I'm gonna go say hi to him.
Are you sure?
Yeah.
I went back into the apartment, and then when I went back out, the car was still there, but neither one of them was there. They were gone. And I was like, oh, Lord.
Megan's friend went up to Megan's apartment to check on her.
Hey.
Oh, hey.
Is everything all right?
Yeah.
You sure?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
She says, I was right. It was my friend from the club. And I looked down to him, and he just nodded his head slowly and didn't say a word. And I didn't speak to him at all either. And I says, well, are you sure you're okay? And she says, yes, I'm fine.
Yeah, okay.
Okay,
call tomorrow.
Okay, I will. Okay, bye.
That would be the last time she would see Megan alive.
When Megan Curl's body was found, there was a remnant of a nightgown on her. We feel like because of that, she knew this person and was preparing for an intimate evening with them.
Investigators questioned many of Megan's male friends, but each had a solid alibi. This sketch is based on Megan's friend's description of the man she saw that night. He is a prime suspect in the murder. He is white, with blonde hair and a mustache. He wore gold-rimmed glasses. Investigators would also like to find this man. He was seen with Megan at the Electric Cowboy Club. He has a dark complexion and may be Hispanic. He is not a suspect, but investigators want to know what he might have seen that night. If you have any information on the murder of Megan Curl, please log on to our website at unsolved.com. Next, a young woman discovers her mother's secret diary and begins a desperate search to find her real father. Jeannie Wagner felt like a misfit in her own family. She had a healthy, normal childhood, but she never really felt like she belonged. Years later, she discovered a family secret that explained why.
From a very early age, I felt very different. And for a while there, I thought, well, you know, maybe I was adopted. And no one intentionally made me feel that way, I don't think, but it was just a knowledge I had that was, I guess, in my subconscious.
Jeannie's mother, Patsy, died when Jeannie was just 21. Only then did she learn about her mother's secret diary. But that was just the first surprise. Jeannie was shocked to find that the man she knew as her father was not really her father at all. In her diary, her mother, Patsy, described meeting a young enlisted man in her hometown of El Paso, Texas. She was just 16 years old, and his name was Duncan.
Hello.
Hi.
Do you mind if I sit down?
I'm Duncan.
Patsy, who was already engaged to someone else, was immediately attracted to this handsome soldier who was gentle and understanding.
I'll see you tomorrow.
Soon, they were seeing each other on a regular basis. Patsy was living a lie, keeping her relationship with Duncan hidden from her fiancé and her family. In October, Patsy panicked when she discovered she was pregnant. Her fiancé believed that he was the father.
I think she was consumed with fear. Fear that her family would think badly of her. It was her belief that it was just unforgivable.
Hi, Patsy.
There's something I want to talk to you about.
Sure, anything.
I've come to a decision.
Patsy, what is it?
Don't be upset, but we can't see each other anymore.
She didn't feel that she could change some things that were already set in motion, which were that she was to be married, and she was to be married to someone that was known and accepted by her family.
Sorry.
The pain of Patsy's dilemma was described in her diary.
I had to do it. I had to please my mother. That was the most important thing in the world. There was no other way.
Patricia Ann Summers, take this man to be your lawfully wedded husband, to have and to hold, to love and to honor.
Patsy and her fiancé were married. Only the two of them knew that Patsy was pregnant. Only Patsy knew that Duncan was the real father.
No one suspected a pregnancy. No one. It was just a wedding, and it was lovely. The night that my sister went into labor, she said to me, tell mother I'm sorry. And what I realized was that she had been pregnant before she was married. But I certainly didn't realize that it went any further than that.
Jeannie was born 7 months after the wedding. In her diary, Patsy described how she prayed for a child with blue eyes like those of her husband. Patsy got her wish.
My firm belief is that secrets only cause people harm, and cause a lot of suffering. And that's why, for me, the truth has to come out, and I have to know who Duncan is.
Update. The night that Jeannie's story aired, a woman named Suzanne Gilmore was watching at her home in South Carolina. At the time, her husband, Duncan, was asleep.
Jeannie's mother had written in her diary that he was the sweetest, kindest person that she had ever met. I just said, that's my Duncan. I knew that it was my Duncan.
And the next thing I know, my wife woke me up and she said, were you ever stationed in El Paso, Texas at Fort Bliss when you were in the Army? And I said, yeah. She said, were you there in 1958? And I said, yeah, I was there in 1958. And she said, did you ever know Patsy Summers? And I said, yeah, I knew Patsy Summers.
Did you sleep with her? And he said, what? He just kind of came awake. And I said, it's very important. Did you sleep with her? And he said,
well, yeah. She said, congratulations, you have a daughter and she's looking for you.
And he just came awake like a shot. It was like, she's looking for me? And I said, yes.
As soon as I heard some of the details, I knew immediately she was my daughter. And it, I don't want to say it was matter of fact, but I just knew that she was my daughter and that we had to be together and I had to see her and I had to respond.
9 days later, Duncan Gilmore and his wife arrived in Houston to meet his daughter, Jeannie, for the first time.
When I hugged my dad, it was a combination of being really, really happy, but also there was a little sadness there.
That so many years have gone by and that we've missed out on each other's lives.
I love you too.
I will always remember Jeannie coming to the door and for the first time seeing my daughter and holding her.
When I saw my boys playing catch with their grandpa, it just felt right. They needed a grandpa, and I can't think of a better grandpa for them to have. Never could I have hoped in a million years or prayed 1,000 prayers for this to turn out as well as it has.